Good morning. Good morning, Facebook. Hold up. Stop what you are doing right now. Today is the book mama's birthday. Yay! So I just wanted to take a moment to celebrate her. We wish you a happy, happy birthday.
I even got balloons.
Yay. And a huge, gigantic heart, y'all.
Y'all got to see this. Is this even, look, it won't even fit on the screen. It's like, this is a Texas-sized birthday card. Woo-hoo. It's crazy. Look at this. This is like insane. Like, it's just going to cover us up. Watch. Woo.
There it is. Because, y'all, she is a big deal. She really, really is. Yes.
I'm a big mess. Yeah.
We're not going to go there. Not on your birthday. We will not go there.
I want to be.
There you go. Yes. Awesome.
Oh my gosh. Hey, would y'all like and share?
Yes.
And tell all of your aspiring author friends that we are on and we're live and we're going to be talking about some interesting editor inside stuff today. Mm-hmm. So I am Dr. Charli, the book mama.
I'm Stephanie Palmer, the grammar queen.
And we're here for a little writer's therapy, our little weekly session for all writers and aspiring writers. Yes. So today we're going to be talking about your writing voice.
Yes.
I love that. It's one of my favorite things. Stephanie has a special name for my writing voice.
What do I have?
You call it the Charli.
Oh, Charli Charm.
Charli Charm. Yes, yes. Yeah. Yeah, it's the Charli Charm. And that's okay. That's a compliment. I like that. Yes. It makes me feel warm and fuzzy inside. But it's just simply writing voice is like a mixture of vocabulary and tone and point of view and syntax and all those really exciting things. Actually, it can be really exciting. So as we get into it today, I think people are going to have a little bit more respect for it. So, so what is your favorite thing about writing voice?
My favorite thing about it, and really as I'm, the whole gist of it is discovering it, really. And I think even as I've been writing, that's really what I've been doing because I really didn't even know it was like a big deal, but it's kind of a big deal because it makes the writer who they are.
It's a big deal.
It's a big deal. So the favorite, I guess my favorite part, I like the description aspect and the tone and, you know, bringing out emotion. I'm really big, especially with a lot of the authors that we have, is bringing that emotion out of them. So I absolutely love being able to do that.
So tone is probably the most important part of your writing voice. Don't you agree?
I agree.
Yeah. I think if you had to like scale them, like the most important, I think tone would be part of your writing voice. So it can be enhanced by punctuation.
Yes.
You know, so that's, if you're really excited, you use an exclamation point.
Right. Not like five of them, just one. Just one.
Well, some people, that's their writing voice, but that doesn't, editors will
enhance that by deleting the exclamation points.
We will. We really, really will. But sometimes it's word choice. You know, I love words.
You are like the queen of words.
I love words, y'all. They just make me gooey inside. They really do. I love to learn new words. And so like an example.
Okay.
So tone can be set. So let's say that you're mad.
Okay.
And your character in your book is mad.
Okay.
If you say they're mad, okay, they're not very happy. You can say they're, you know, or maybe they're upset. So that's not quite mad, but it's not happy either. Or you could say they're angry.
Yes.
Okay. Then you have a different emotion, a different perspective. You could say they are livid. Okay.
Yes.
That's completely different, right? And then now I learned this. All right. So according to generations younger than I, so you can go fed.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
We were having this discussion before.
Yeah, go fed. So maybe there are some younger writers on here who know what that means. I actually had to resort to the Urban Dictionary and Minds that have not yet reached 20. So You know, that's okay because I'm learning go fed. You know, we come up with words like dope and sick and
lit
and it's got drip. Yeah. So again, but that's tone.
Yes.
That's tone. Your word choice really affects your tone.
Yes.
Can you think of other examples?
Tone. Well, and like you said, I guess even the emotion. So the biggest emotions that you have with tone are going to be, you know, like joyful, serious, humorous, sad, formal, informal, optimistic, pessimistic, and horror. So those are the ones, you know, as I was looking information up, you know, that's what they shared. But like I said, I guess I come from a place of, I guess the emotion, whatever I'm experiencing in that moment is really what I try to bring to the reader to draw that out of them as well. So like as I'm writing, a lot of my stuff has been, you know, more about, I guess, on the good side of things, like the optimistic side, as opposed to, you know, angry or anything else like that. I just want to bring joy and
optimism. Well, and again, tone is about word choice. And right. If you're wanting to bring optimism and encouragement, there are certain words you use. If you want to reach a more sophisticated writer, you know, you might have a serendipitous experience.
Where do you pull these words from, y'all? Know,
a quintessential conglomeration of verbiage that can reach even, you know, the most simple of people.
Yeah.
Sure. I don't know, but just saying it's possible that you want to talk like that. Okay. So, but that's a tone.
Right.
But again, those people who understand that getting angry is to go fed are not going to read a serendipitous quintessential book. They're going to go, look at that spaghetti on the page. Okay. So tone, you know, involves that word choice in your emotion, and it really, okay. So serendipitous really has to do with that jovial, encouraging, you know,
I'm gonna let you have salient, that one. You and Webster can have that
tone that you were talking about, but it reaches a different audience.
Right.
So, sometimes informal, now you have heard us fuss that there is just some informal language you can't write in a book. Now,
it's best not to write it. Now, you can choose to write it.
You
we
can
don't
choose
encourage it.
But we're going to go, no, please don't. I really like, for example, LOL. That's probably the simplest one. Text language, we don't really like to see that used in a book. Now, the exception would be if you are actually discussing a text conversation in your manuscript, LOL would be appropriate.
Yes.
But you can't, if you're trying to be funny, you can't add LOL every other sentence.
Yes. Don't tell the
your
reader
other
to laugh.
Language is supposed to make them laugh. You're not, it's not a cue card at The Price is Right where people are supposed to clap or laugh.
They're supposed to what?
Clap or laugh.
Oh, okay. I thought you said clap or laugh.
I might have. It's my birthday. I might have. As of today, I have 47 reasons I might get my vocabulary mixed up.
Hey, there you go.
Okay, so one of the things that I think is really interesting is sometimes we have authors who are not funny, but they want to be funny.
Right.
And I get that. I get that. I like to be funny, but sometimes what I'm writing, I really don't need to be funny.
Yeah.
It's not a funny moment. Yeah. It's not a funny situation.
It's like a bad joke and you're just sitting there awkward after after you read it.
Right.
It's kind of like, what did I just read?
That makes me think, what does a West Texas photographer drive?
Oh my gosh, really, we're doing this? I have no idea. What do they drive?
A Camry.
Oh my gosh, really?
I love that joke.
Y'all be sure to use that later on today.
Right? Okay. So what other things contribute to your writing voice?
Well, I want to say when I'm going backwards. So it's really the voice about being the personality. And I look at it as, you know, like each of us are individuals. We all have, you know, a different thumbprint, and it kind of, you know, correlates with writing. It's, we're all individuals. So no one is going to write like the other person. I will segue and say that typically when I'm reading someone's book, and I go to write, sometimes I'll carry some of those things with me just because it's like subconsciously in me that I've been doing that. But I just have to put a disclaimer out there too. When you're reading someone's book, say you get someone's book that you know, do you read it in their voice or is it just me? Like in my head,
no, I do.
In my head, I read it in their voice.
And so several years ago, I wrote a book and I shared it with some friends, you know, to read it before.
I wasn't her friend. Like she didn't share it with me.
You might
y'all pray for us.
You might have been in high school. Anyway, but so I shared it with some friends of mine, and you're talking about personality. And the response was, I can so hear you when I read this because your personality came out in your writing and in your stories. And I thought that was pretty cool.
That's the whole gist of it. I do.
So how do you how do you place personality with an author that you don't know?
Oh, that's a really good question. You would put me on the spot, huh?
That's why they call me Dr. Charli.
I'm not sure. Well, and I guess, you know, reading, I mean, you look for the personality through the book and the message that they're trying to share. So the words that they use and everything else. But like I said, I love being able to pull emotion out. So like my favorite thing is being able to, you know, ask the hard questions to get them to share. So instead of just sharing a bunch of facts, you know, put emotion behind it so that it helps the reader learn more about, you know, where, what place you were in that moment that you were writing.
Yeah. Yeah. And
so I didn't answer your question though.
No, but that's okay. There's not really, I don't know that there's a right or wrong answer to the question.
That's true.
It's just something to think about. If we can place personality with an author when we're reading the book, it does make it more enjoyable for the reader. But at the same time, when you don't, I mean, really, how many people have ever heard Stephen King's voice?
Right. Yeah, probably.
I mean, according to the number of books he sold, I seriously doubt that most of those people have ever actually heard him speak. So having his, now, does he do his own books on Audible? I don't know.
I have no idea.
But if he did, that might would help. You know, that might would help. Right. So, can you imagine having something I've written read in like a New Jersey accent?
That would be hilarious.
I know, right? Or having something that somebody from Massachusetts wrote, have me read it out loud. That would, that would be really funny. At least it is funny in my own mind between my two ears. So perspective also affects your voice.
Yes.
Okay, so it's different from personality, though. Two P words.
Got it.
Different meaning. Mm-hmm. So perspective is when you are telling a story from a different position in the context. Mm. So I can't remember the name of the book right now, but a while back. Did you get that?
I got
personality?
It.
Yeah. A while back, I read a book about an oil tycoon who discovered oil, and, you know, he made his family wealthy, and it was like a generational thing, and it kind of went through the generations and how the discovery of oil on their land had affected them. A whole Jed Clampett kind of concept.
Okay.
So, you know, that
sets the tone, right?
Jed Clampett.
Beverly Hills. Okay, yeah. I was gonna go there, but
I'm so glad she knew that. Okay, that was like my birthday present. All right, so
still doesn't make me want to watch Star Trek.
Star Wars.
Yeah, see, look, anything.
Oh my gosh,
Star.
If you did not get that, you need to go back a couple of episodes. Anyway, so this book was written by the man who discovered the oil.
Okay.
And so it told the story of his family. But what if what if the story had been written by his wife? What if she told the story from her perspective?
Right.
The voice might have sounded differently.
Right.
He might have been really excited about all those hours and all those sacrifices, and it was worth it. And, you know, what it felt like as a man to discover. But the wife might have been like, he wasn't home for dinner and he was disrespectful and blah, blah, you know, might have had something to say. And then another perspective that would have affected voice could have been if someone in the community wrote it. So, I mean, because once they discovered oil, then oil, I'm sorry, you know, in Texas and Louisiana, we say oil. So it does have an I in the word oil.
That personality is coming out.
Right. So if the community was affected by their discovery of oil, so if someone from the community wrote it, their perspective would have been very different because it boomed the whole economy, not just this personal family's finances. So perspective really changed your voice as well. Yes.
Yeah. And even you look at it. So if you're, And I just go back to this because I know that we have a lot of authors that experience this. So if you're at a place of pain, your perspective is going to be different from once you've healed from that situation. It's going to be a totally different dynamic, a totally different voice. All of that is going to come out in your tone because you were still hurting from a situation you haven't been healed from.
Right.
Yeah.
Or it could just be the point of view that you have on something.
Yes, absolutely.
Like when I write about Star Wars, I have a sense of excitement in what I write.
And I have a sense of confusion and
disdain.
Well, not, I guess so, but I just, I'm just not thrilled about it. Like,
right. Yeah. A lackluster
tone.
Yeah. There you go. Lackluster. There's a word I don't think we've used before. So, okay. So
there's not many that you haven't used, so.
Oh, no, that's not true. There's at least 2,000 pages left in Webster's Dictionary that I haven't touched yet.
Let that be your challenge for this year.
I don't know that the next 365 days is enough time for me to cover all those words. Okay, I want to talk about rhythm.
Okay. I don't have any, so.
Okay, so rhythm is not like bump bump. Yeah. It is, well, although it can be.
Yeah, it can be.
But in writing, it really covers some different things. Like rhythm, if you really want to like fire point and just get to the point quick and prove a point, like
quick jabs,
right? Then your paragraphs and your sentences as well might be really short. Okay. But if you are, you want to have a real discourse on a thought process, then your paragraph and your sentences may be longer. Right. And so that's actually a rhythm that's just inherent in the writing that the reader picks up on.
Yes.
Okay. But you also have more fun things. Anyway, we have funner things like alliteration and parallelism.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember what is alliteration?
I do not remember, but I know that you know. So I rely on you for things like that.
Stephanie cites silly syllogisms.
Oh, it's all the starting with the same letter.
It's when something starts with the same letter or has the same vowel sounds in the word. Okay.
Yeah, I haven't went that far.
Yeah. No. So, but there are some people who write that way. And the reason they write that way is because it makes a point. Did you know that restaurants, I love it when you look at me like that.
She's going to drop some gems, y'all. It's going to be like Darren says, some value bombs. Are y'all ready for
value bombs? All right. Did you know that when you name a restaurant something that has alliteration in it, or so it rhymes, it starts with the same letter, it has the same vowel sound or something, it's more likely to be successful?
Really? Interesting.
Yeah. I have no idea where I learned that, but I took it and I owned it. So
So could you give us an example? Like, I'm just trying to even think off the top of my head. Am I challenging you?
You are.
Okay, we don't have to go there.
I'm sorry. I don't know that I've ever had to prove that.
I need you to bring an example when you bring facts.
Well,
like,
just
I need an example.
Into my head.
Oh, well, that's scary.
It just suddenly go kind of like the balloons behind us, and I just thought, oh, let me share. Now I'm really regretting that. Okay. That'll teach me to share my thoughts.
Right.
Okay, so alliteration really, especially with kids' books, alliteration yes. helps them learn sounds. It helps them learn, you know, we talked about that last week. So that can be really a really fun element.
Yes.
But parallelism. Y'all, this is one of my favorite ways to write. This is my own, one of my own personal ways to incorporate my voice in writing, and I know that. And so that would be to make certain that if you're trying to sway someone, if you're trying to hone in on a point and really make it memorable without saying, you better remember this. Okay. Parallelism is a great way to do this. Jesus did this a lot. You know, that
parables?
Red text in the Bible, not parables.
Okay.
He did it in parables, but okay. Parallelism.
Got it.
So a parallel is when something is the same, right? So you may start your sentence with an ing word.
Okay. I know where you're
so
going with this.
You're going to the store, and then you're sailing home, and then you're buying another yacht. I don't know where that came from. But anyway, so it every sentence ends with an ing word. Or it's possible that you are starting the sentence with the same phrase every sentence in the paragraph, or like the last three sentences of the paragraph. So students need to sit with their laptops open. Students need to sit with their laptops being, or students need to sit and act engaged. Students need to keep their pie hole shut when the teacher is talking. Okay.
Got
you
it.
See, that's the parallelism.
Yeah.
Okay. And what it does is it emphasizes a point without saying, hey, you know, you don't have to use bold font. You don't have to use all caps. It's your language that is repeated because the brain is actually designed to remember repetition. Mm-hmm. So when something is repeated, it's more likely to stick. So especially if you are trying to persuade in your book, then that is a tip that you can use that's really, really handy. So
we won't charge you for that.
Oh,
we're not charging.
Was it that valuable?
That was a good tip.
Oh, thanks.
Yes.
That makes me feel better because I didn't have an example.
Okay. Well, you did. You used the student example. So you did. You shared the example.
I redeemed myself.
You did. You so
I am redeemed,
yourself.
Y'all. Woo-hoo. I'm redeemed.
Okay, so let me just ask you, why is it important to have a writing voice? Like, why do you need it?
I think it adds flavor to what you write. It, how would you justify it?
Well, I think especially for those that have written multiple books, having that same voice throughout, it just continues to draw the reader in. If they enjoyed the first one, 9 times out of 10, your voice is going to keep showing up in those other books, and it's going to keep the readers engaged. And even then, like with speakers that go and speak, when they hear, you know, your voice, and they connect with you this way, and they get your book,
right,
9 times out of 10, it's going to be aligned to some degree most of the times, because even though we don't write, we don't write how we talk in the sense of, you know, incorrect grammar and all that, right? But just having that voice, it just keeps the reader engaged with the author.
Right. One of the ways we've had the preposition talk before.
We have had the preposition talk.
Yeah. So that's a way that voice comes out in writing that isn't always strong writing.
Right.
It doesn't mean that as an author, you can't control how and what you say. If you're writing fiction and you're trying to add colloquial speech to a character, it's totally acceptable.
Give us an example.
Tom Sawyer. The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn.
Yeah.
They use colloquial language to
I can't remember
Mark Twain?
I can't remember it. Like, that wasn't something that stood out
to me.
Well,
I'm just saying that's an example of colloquial language that they used. But in the South, it is very common to say, where are y'all from? From is a preposition. And technically, in English language rules, you may not end a sentence with the preposition.
Although, and some of our authors do, I'm guilty of it too, y'all.
Y'all, I'm guilty of it. I have to check myself on a daily basis because that's the way we talk. Now, if it's relevant to the writing, if it adds flavor, if I'm writing something that is very local, it's for community, I want to really reach all levels of readers on a local level, I may write that way. But if I'm writing a book that I intend to go nationwide, people from another state north of the Mason-Dixon line might say, why are you talking like that? So it's just a thing.
Yeah.
So, but it's just something that popped in my head. So how do you get your writing voice?
I think the two biggest things that what I'm working on as I'm discovering my voice is number one, writing.
FYI, I mean, y'all, she has a voice. She uses it on me all the time.
Well, I'm still working. I'm working on discovering it for myself, I guess. Other people may see it.
I found it. She don't need to discover nothing. I'll share it with you.
with that, writing and then being authentic. I think a lot of times, not comparing myself to other writers, even though I can pull things from other writers, I don't want to be a copy. I want to be an original. I want to be me, and showing up as me in my writing is what I've really been.
You really want to achieve that quintessential identity stamp.
Yeah. And so when someone reads something, they're like, oh yeah, I know that she wrote this. Like, this is her. This is her all day. And then, you know, of course, when people read my books, I want them to read it in my voice.
Right? Because you have such a great voice. So actually, I have an exercise for you.
I need to exercise. No, okay, let's go. Okay.
It won't be too taxing.
Okay. Okay. I don't need to do jumping jacks or anything to write.
So this is something that anybody can do. All right. Okay. If you're kind of curious what your voice is in writing. All right. So what I would like for you to do is give me three words that describe Stephanie, the grammar queen, Palmer.
Three words that describe me. I think energetic.
Okay.
Encouraging.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to pull one from the sky. Let me see. Let me do ambitious.
Ambitious. Okay. All right. So if you want to do this exercise at home or at work on your jog run, I don't know. But find three words that you think describe you well. And then ask others to give you three words that describe you well. So I have three words to describe
you. Okay, let's hear them.
I think that you are a scholar. A scholar is someone who is always learning. They're hungry to absorb new information and learn new things. And that is Stephanie Palmer. Love her guts for that. Okay, the second is you're systematic or organized. Okay, and three is that you're dedicated. She's very dedicated. When she really believes in something, she's very dedicated to it. Okay. And it doesn't, if she gets off track, it doesn't take long for her to come back around. She's still dedicated. She just got to refocus a little bit. I love that about her. Okay. So if you put all those together, that is your voice. So your voice is energetic, encouraging, ambitious, scholarly, organized, and dedicated.
I like it.
That would be your writing voice. And really, that is your writing voice. It is. When she writes, she's very encouraging and ambitious, and she's motivating people. But she wants to be organized in how she writes. She does not want it to be scattered. So, yeah. So see, there's your writing voice.
I want to do you, but I didn't think of your words in advance because you didn't tell me about this exercise we were doing.
Well, we can do that another time.
Okay.
We can do
I'm
that
another time. I'm going to challenge
you. Okay. Okay, so we talked about rhythm a little bit, but we left out something really important.
What did we leave out?
I'm a poet. Did you know it?
I was going to say that. I mean, like, not say that exactly, but I was going to talk about poetry.
You're a poet too? Who knew?
No, I'm not. I'm not a poet. You know what? I actually am. I used to write poetry in high school. Like, I mean, that took me back, but.
Are you getting what I'm doing?
Yes. Rhyme.
Rhyme.
Rhythm, rhyme. I got it. I got it. I'm following.
So part of rhythm is rhyme. I left that out a while ago.
I was gonna circle back, but then when you did the exercise and it threw me off.
Yes. Exercising always throws me off. It's like, I actually almost fell off the treadmill this morning. Oh, so, yeah.
I'm so glad you didn't do that on your birthday. That might have been good.
Oh, my goodness. So, do you think that people struggle with voice?
Yes and no. It goes back to being authentic.
We would love to hear y'all's comments, by the way. If you struggle with voice, we would really love to know.
Yeah. Well, and I know you do this exercise, but for me, in my mind, I feel like I struggle with it because, I mean, I really do. Just being completely honest, I'm working toward figuring it out and playing around with different tones and different, not that my personality is going to change, but I do. I feel like I struggle with it. I mean, you made a great point, but.
You know, I just thought of a tone tool, a voice tool that we have not mentioned.
What is that?
Writing in metaphors. Writing in metaphors. So some people are so good at metaphors, they write metaphors inside their metaphors, and that can be kind of confusing. Unless maybe you've had a couple of glasses of wine, then maybe it's just fun. But
maybe they were drinking wine when they were writing it.
but writing in metaphors, because that alone is a voice that paints a picture. That's the whole purpose of writing metaphorically, is that you're painting a picture for someone.
Give me an example of a metaphor.
Okay. So when you are writing, so I have these beautiful flowers on my desk. Y'all can't see them. And so you could talk about a young lady and she is the flower. And so she starts out as the bud, and then with the right tender, loving care, she begins to open up and bloom as a young woman and becomes a beautiful example of what God intended her to be. So that's a metaphor. So I talk about her as a bud. I talk about her as a flower. I talk about the nurturing that she needs, just like a plant needs to be nurtured with water and nutrients. There's nurturing that's involved with a young woman or a young man. Okay. So I just, normally you don't talk about young men as blooms.
Yeah. Let's not go there.
Normally. So that's an example of a metaphor.
Good job.
Thanks.
Challenged
you. Redeemed myself again.
You did a great job.
I am redeemed. Okay.
So rhyming.
We were talking about squirrels earlier.
Yeah.
We've had a lot of squirrel talk, y'all. Okay. I have to tell y'all, the only way my children remember my birthday is because it's the opening day of squirrel season in East Texas. If that doesn't make you laugh, nothing will. I'm just saying, every year I am reminded that my birthday is the same day as the opening day of squirrel season. Oh, I don't know if that's funny or sad, but it is a fact. Okay, so squirrel, we were talking about rhythm.
We were talking about rhyming. Yes.
So what do you have to pontificate about rhyming?
Well, I know the poetry aspect with rhyming is, you know, that's great. I think even with children's books, rhyming is an awesome tool to use when you're doing children's books, because it creates a rhythm.
It's not just for poetry.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I completely agree. So here's the thing, guys. If you struggle with finding your voice, if you really want to write a book and you're struggling with that, we would love to help you out.
Yes, yes, yes. Yeah,
don't freak out because you think you don't know what your voice is. Okay. Right. You don't need a megaphone to suddenly discover what your voice is. Your voice is inside of you, just like I just did with Stephanie a while ago. And we're happy to help you do that.
Yes. Yes,
and if
yes.
you're already writing and you feel like your voice is not coming out, I'm willing to bet that you just don't realize it's already there. And we're mm-hmm. happy to help you see that and happy to help you accentuate that.
Yes.
So as long as it doesn't have LOL.
Yeah, please don't. But I will say, even there are some people that are kind of, I guess, not scared, but they don't want someone to change. You know, we have some authors, it's like, I don't want you to change anything. And I really think it's because they fear that we're going to take their voice away. And that's not what we do. But I will tell you, there are sometimes I read something and even though it could be grammatically correct, I'll be like, I would have said that a different way, but that's my voice. And it's not my job to make someone else's writing be, you know, predicated right. toward what I think. It's enhancing their voice.
Right. And so I want to put a plug in for a minute about ghostwriting.
Mm.
Because ghostwriting, it really takes some skill.
Yes.
Because you as the writer, we ghostwrite here. And as the writer, we have to get to know.
Yes.
The author, because we're technically not the author, we're the ghostwriter. We have to know their voice. We have to know their story. We have to spend time with them. We have to absorb.
Learn their personalities. Mm-hmm. Yeah, all of that.
So, you know, we're ghostwriting, or I'm ghostwriting right now, a mm-hmm. book for the company. And the gentleman that we're ghostwriting for, he had all this training online. And I went and listened to all of it. But I learned a lot. And the thing is I was able to really glean what his voice was.
Mm, yeah,
so that
good.
Later as I was writing, I could put in phrases that I know he used on a regular basis. So it really has his voice in the book, because
yes.
that really matters. It's his book.
Right.
So just a little plug for ghostwriting there.
Yeah.
If a ghostwriter doesn't have that skill and that ability, then,
yeah.
then you need to find another ghostwriter.
Right. Absolutely.
So, okay.
Before we end it, because it looks like we're getting ready to close out.
Right.
I really feel like, if y'all have any questions, if you have subjects that you want us to discuss, we would absolutely love to get that feedback. Let us know how we can help you.
As long as it's about books.
Yeah, as long as it's about books. We're not going to do any like real one-on-one therapy sessions.
We don't do politics.
We don't do politics. We're not going to do any of that fun stuff, but we will right. focus on books and how we can help you. Reach out to us at selfpublishin30days@gmail.com. Send us your questions. Let us know how we can better assist you with the writing process.
Right. The other thing you can do is set up a consult with us. You can go to selfpublishin30days.com. And did I say that right?
Yeah. Yes.
And selfpublishin30days.com and set up a consult with us. And we'd love to visit with you about your book and,
yes.
and discuss any concerns you have or questions about the process. So
yep.
if you do that, you can also get a free ebook.
Yes, you can. You can
absolutely.
And we'll send you additional resources and however we can help, we'll definitely do that.
We are co-presidents of resources.
Yes.
We have resources. So.
On top of resources.
What she said.
Yeah.
All right. This is Dr. Charli, the book mama.
This is Stephanie Palmer, the grammar queen.
And we hope you have a great week.
Bye.